Dear students, welcome to the Visual Analytics lecture on scatterplots. We already had two video lectures on this topic. Scatterplots are really important, frequently used in information visualization and often combined with cluster analysis, for example, outlier detection or regression lines, which makes it also an essential visual analytics tool. You remember that overplotting was an essential problem. And we discussed several solutions, for example, based on aggregation of the data, leading to density plots or bint representations. And the last thing we have discussed in the last video lecture were splatter plots, a variant of scatter plots that's particularly designed for multi-class scatter plots. So the different colors here denote different classes, for example, resulting from clustering or based on a classification of the data that was a priori available. And the basic idea of splatter plots is to show enclosing shapes for each class, transparently rendered so that overlaps can be shown correctly in order to represent the extent of the individual classes. The shapes were nicely smoothed in order to emphasize their general shape and not distract the viewer with details. Yeah. The last remark here was that this can also be used to compare one cluster to the overall distribution. So often it's quite interesting to see whether there is one class or cluster that strongly depends on the overall behavior. Yeah, that could be particularly interesting. Yeah, some more ideas and thoughts on advanced scatterplots. An idea from Daniel Keim and colleagues is generalized scatterplots, where he makes the basic observation that there has to be a trade-off if you have a large amounts of data between either an overlap-free view and undistorted view, or a view where you tolerate a considerable amount of overlap. That means overplotting occurs. And which trade-off is acceptable could be decided by the user. So for example, he could have a slider available to indicate whether he is primarily interested in an undistorted view or he is primarily interested in avoiding overplotting. And probably it's a good idea to look at different representations where different amounts of overlapping are adjusted. Yeah. So for any point in the output view, in the scatter plot, we check how often it is used so far. If the counter for a particular point P is below a threshold that was adjusted before, this point is drawn or overdrawn if it is not for the first time. If the threshold is exceeded, we search in the neighborhood, yeah, direct neighbors, or if this is not successful, even further neighbors, until we found a point Q in the neighborhood of P where the counter, how often this point was used already, is below a threshold. Yeah? And then the representation is updated accordingly. So here you see an initial example where we have a large amount of overlapping. So many, many points are here in this small area of the scatter plots and they are overplotted. Here, on the other hand, we use a considerable amount of distortion in the sense that instead of drawing P, which was already drawn, we draw Qs in the neighborhood, in the surrounding. Yeah? And here this is even done more extensively and it leads to the fact that we basically see all the points here, which indicates a little bit how many points actually are hidden behind this small spot that you see here. Yeah? If you compare this representation with this one, this gives you an impression of the amount of overplotting that you have here. So as said already, it's a good idea to look at several representations. Yeah, one of the last things I wanted to discuss related to scatter plots is the idea of skagnostics and how skagnostics can be used for exploration. Skagnostics is a word that's composed of scatterplot. Yeah, so the first letters here come from scatterplot, and the last come from diagnostics. Yeah, so we diagnose, that means we analyze scatterplots, we derive certain values, certain quantitative measures. In the original publication on this topic from Wilkinson, these were 9 attributes. Yeah, and this is useful in order to search within a large amount of scatterplots. So why should we search within a large amount of scatterplots? Well, if we have high dimensional data, 100 dimensions, then we have 10,000 pairwise correlations, attributes, leading to 10,000 scatterplots, and probably we do not have time to look at all of them in particular. But we could be interested in scatterplots where we have a particular low or particular high number of outliers. Yeah, that would be one of these 9 measures, outlierness. Yeah, so we can perform a similarity-based search. If we start with 1 scatterplot, we could look for other scatterplots that have similar characteristics, similar features in terms of the diagnostics of scatterplots. Yeah, here are these 9 measures: outlying, skewed distributions, clumpy, or sparse. Sparseness is very high here. Yeah, we have only very few points that are far away. Here we have moderate sparseness, and here sparseness is very low. Yeah, striated means that we have such elongated patterns strongly. This occurs here on the right. So on the right is always where this value is particularly high, and on the left is where this value is particularly low. Monotonic basically means that we have a strong correlation in the data. Yeah, then it's monotone. Stringy is a bit similar to striated because we also have elongated patterns, but they could be arbitrarily elongated, could be representing some oscillations in the data. Yeah, here the data is highly convex. The convex hull of all the points represents this point set very well, whereas the convex hull here would not represent the point set very well. The convex hull basically would be the whole area of the scatter plot. Yeah, so these are 9 measures that can be automatically derived. I have not formally explained how this is computed. That's a part of the paper, of course. But my goal here is to give you an intuition and idea about such measures. Yeah, and to give at least a rough idea of how some of these measures can be computed, there are some techniques from algorithmic geometry that are employed to the point set that represent a scatter plot. So for example, the minimum spanning tree is computed, and then you may ask, for example, how many branchings we have here. That tells you about some scagnostic features. Alpha shapes are computed and convex hulls. Yeah, both are enclosing shapes, alpha shapes and convex hulls. You see that this is the same point set here and here and here also. Yeah, the convex hull is larger. Yeah, so whether or not the point set has a high convexivity could be analyzed by comparing the area of alpha shapes with the convex hull. If this would be really convex, then the convex hull would be the same like the alpha shape. Yeah, here it's not the case. We have a large concave area, so therefore alpha shapes are quite different from the convex hull. Yeah, so these are geometric representations that help to compute the scagnostic measures. So I like examples, and my hope is that things get a little bit more understandable with good examples. These 3 scatter plots contain 1 dot for every country of the world. And for every country of the world, it is registered by the World Health Organization, for example, what the life expectancy is. And there are distinct differences between males and females. As you may know, in Germany, for example, the life expectancy of females is 6 years higher than for males. So that's distinguished between males and females. And that is what you see here in the scatter plot. Basically, if in a certain country females have a low life expectancy, then males also will have a low life expectancy, and if the life expectancy for a country is higher for females, then it's also higher for males. Yeah, that is the average tendency. One may think for a moment, why is this the case? Probably because in a certain country, either the air quality or the water quality is good or bad, and then it is good or bad for females and males as well. The healthcare system typically has the same quality for females and males, so therefore it is reasonable to assume that the life expectancy in countries grows in a similar way. But you see some outliers here. Yeah, so if you would search for scatterplots with a higher value of outlierness, you would locate these scatterplots where three countries have a rather low life expectancy for males, although the female life expectancy is higher. And why is this? Because these countries in these years, 1983 to 1985, had a war in their country. So therefore, many males died in the war, and the number of females that died was considerably lower. You know that in a war, of course, also civilists may die, and that includes women, of course, as well. But the soldiers are male, at least predominantly in most countries. Moreover, soldiers are quite young. Yeah, not only that more soldiers died, but they are 20 years on average. So that has a clear influence on life expectancy. Yeah, here you see indeed a larger number of scatter plots, and clustering was applied here in order to show which different types of clusters we have in our set here. And for each cluster representing many scatter plots, in this example more than 1,000, one representative is shown. The size of the rectangle demonstrates or indicates how many of these scatter plots we have. Yeah, here you see a cluster with a few dozens of scatter plots from thousands of scatter plots that comprise the overall set. Yeah, and here you see how they are arranged in a certain metric of Skagnostic's measures. Yeah, Skagnostic-based exploration is scalable with respect to the number of dimensions. Yeah, this type of analysis based on clustering could be applied really if we have a large amount of scatterplots. Yeah, so you may ask, who is really able to efficiently use such a tool? And if you have the right attitude, you could be skeptical that end users without any strong education in visualization and data analysis are able to use such tools. That's correct. Yeah, that is not an end user tool, but it could be interesting for end users, provided that they can closely collaborate with a data scientist. Yeah, so the data scientist having some understanding of what the end user is interested in, what he may want to see, can make suggestions for probably interesting scatterplot-based visualizations. Then he can discuss with the domain expert and refine the visualization and provide further information. I want to discuss also one topic that could be considered a bit exotic, but I can imagine that the practical implications are quite strong. More and more users in companies employ their smartphones, being outside of an office and of the company, having access to certain data and want to explore data. So they have only small screens. You cannot come up with showing them a scatterplot matrix, for example. Yeah. In this example here from Büring et al., from Konstanz, they mentioned salespersons and real estate experts as examples for such mobile users of data. We discussed as one idea to explore the data that we show scatter plots and enable the user to select single points or a few points and then get more detailed information for the selection in a separate window. Yeah, that would follow the details on demand strategy. But that does not work with a small screen. Yeah, with a small screen, we need the whole space for a scatter plot. Yeah, so overview and detail need to be integrated in one screen. That's the consequence. Yeah, and that could be achieved with a smooth transition between a visualization with detail and without detail, using fisheye zoom, which combines geometric distortions and semantic zoom. So what does fisheye mean? Fisheye is a term that comes from photography. It refers to wide angle lenses that somehow distort what you see. Certain parts of the scene that you are photographing are shown in more detail, enlarged, and others are smaller. And that, of course, could be realized also with a computer algorithm that helps to show some focus region enlarged, and other parts of the data is shown in a shrinked way that is not enlarged. And this enlarging is combined with what is called a semantic zoom, namely that the level of detail is automatically adjusted. Actually, we want to enlarge something because we want to accommodate further information. We want to show more details. And to make this legible, we need more space, and therefore it is enlarged. That is what is meant here with combining geometric distortions, making things larger, with semantic zoom, where the level of detail is adapted. Yeah. So zooming targets at one item, after one item was explored, another item could be explored. After a certain delay, small delay, the zooming process starts automatically. The delay is important because otherwise it may be that this is not intended by the user. Yeah, he should have a chance of just looking at something without starting this process. Yeah, so let me see some screenshots from their work. That was an initial scatter plot based representations. Yeah, these are years here, so that's temporal information, and some attribute here changed over time, and that is visible in the scatter plot. Some filtering is applied here with this range slider, so only certain values are actually shown here. That is the initial representation. After the user selected a region, it is enlarged. You see more details in the temporal domain, so that starts here from July 2004 to July 2005, a one-year period, whereas here we have approximately 7 or 8 years. And also here the range is considerably smaller. It's between 2.9 and 3.5 instead of the interval from 2 to 7. Yeah? At least one order of magnitude, this is smaller. And then the user zooms in even more and now has individual elements. Yeah? What was a point here now is a rectangle that contains some information. Actually, that is a book database, so the individual elements that you see here are books with their titles and title page and the author. Yeah. So here you see only the books that appeared in April 2005. Yeah, and only with a certain value here. I'm not sure what this is, the price of the book or whatever. Yeah. And here it's even shown in full detail, so that you have one selected entry where you can read the title, you see the title page, and you can fully read the author name. Yeah, and then you may select another item here, and then with zooming, continuously zooming, you come up with such a representation again. Yeah, so there are some thresholds built in that say if the size of an element exceeds a certain limit, then we switch the representation to a more detailed one, from a point to a rectangle, from a rectangle to a rectangle where we can write the title of the book, to an even larger rectangle that can accommodate even more information. Yeah. So here we have four levels of detail combined with this zooming operation. So, and one more technique I think is quite important is to use animation to represent scatterplot based information. Animations could be considered as useful because humans are very familiar with interpreting motion. Yeah, that's based on our evolution. We had to be aware of things that approach us. We had to estimate the speed with which something approaches us. Is it dangerous or not? So human motion perception actually is quite sophisticated. But of course, it cannot interpret all motions perfectly correctly. Yeah, the number of objects that change their position should be restricted if we assume that users really perceive all these movements. And movements can be simpler, for example, if they follow a linear path, or they could be more complex, yeah, if something goes like this, and you cannot follow several complex movements. I guess that a considerable portion of you has some experiences with computer games. Yeah? In computer games, you often have enemies and you have to escape from them, and you know the more enemies you have, the more difficult this gets, and it depends also on the speed of the enemies that you have, and also on the complexity of the movements. Yeah, fast movements are perceived as urgent. Yeah, we have to really understand them and think about whether we should respond to them. Slow movements are not considered as urgent, and if they occur in the periphery of our visual field, we may overlook them. Yeah, so what's easier to interpret is if you have few items that move, if they move linearly or on smooth trajectories, that means on an arc, for example, and if several items follow similar directions, so that you can perceive a grouping of elements that moves in a certain direction, that is in general quite easy to interpret. Yeah. So animation may be incorporated to support the interaction with a static data set. For example, if you change a parameter, then instead of changing this scatterplot to this scatterplot, you can animate this to show a smooth transition that makes it easy for you to observe how one representation was generated out of the other representation. Yeah, that is one idea of using animation, and the second idea is to show indeed dynamic data sets. Yeah, we have seen this example of male and female life expectancy for different years, and we created three different scatterplots for each year. Well, with three scatterplots, that's possible, but if we want to show the development of the whole 20th century, then 100 scatterplots would arise. That's too much to see. Yeah. Then an animation could be more useful. Yeah. So for dynamic data, users need tight control over animation speed to inspect relevant intervals in detail and skip over others. Yeah, I want to make you aware of this, and therefore I cited this statement. Yeah. Here are some examples. We look at some small videos that show how something changes over time. We have not too many elements here, and what you see here is a screenshot, and that not only provides the information for the current point in time, but with this trail here also indicates the last points in time, the recent points in time. Yeah. So let's have a look at this small video sequence. Really a short one. So my internet seems to be quite slow, but now we have it. Yeah, and you see the movement of data. Yeah, that gives a tendency. These are different classes, blue, green, and red. And that is visible here. Yeah, let me make a few remarks on the evaluation of scatterplot displays. It's
good to evaluate such systems by comparing different variants. Yeah, you get more interesting feedback from users when you not only ask them, here is our system and what do you think about it, but if users have different variants available and should comment on the strengths and disadvantages of them. You need to prepare this, of course, quite well, the techniques that you want to compare, but you also need good data sets, a representative set of test data. Yeah, you want to understand whether your scatterplot-based display is able to convey clusters in the data very well, or outliers, or correlations. Yeah, so you need different data sets where there are clusters that are easy to separate or more difficult to separate, correlations. And then the question is, if you have different variants, different binning strategies, for example, if you have some kind of aggregated visualization, how are the different variants assessed? You see here an example, three images from the paper from Michael Siedelmeier and colleagues, different data sets, multi-class data sets. So we have three different classes or clusters. And you see that the separability, of course, depends primarily on the data set here. Yeah. So users are asked with different variants of a visualization how well they can separate the clusters. They are asked to assess the correlation, and that can be compared with the true correlation, of course. And they should also be asked in the trust of their interpretation. Yeah. So these are a few remarks on the evaluation. Let me summarize this discussion of scatterplots. I think it became clear that scatterplots are frequently used as an information visualization techniques, both for experts, but also for broader audiences. You see more and more also scatterplots in online visualizations of the Zeit, for example, or other journals. Scatterplot displays are often enhanced with the results of a cluster analysis and the results of regression analysis. So that makes it then more a visual analytics kind of visualization. We discussed to considerable extent the overplotting problem that occurs if you have many, many data sets and then the same point is needed again and again in the scatterplot. And different strategies were used in order to reduce or avoid the overplotting problems. To briefly summarize this again, to adapt color or transparency on how frequently overplotted a point is a simple strategy. Another rather simple strategy is jittering, where you displace one point if it is overplotted. You do search for free space in the surrounding. That works until to a certain extent. Yeah, at some point there is no more free space available. And we discussed binning grid-based strategies where instead of showing the raw data, which is too much, aggregated data is shown. That can be always done. So there is no longer an overplotting problem, but that is achieved at the expense of seeing no longer the individual data. Yeah, density plots, jitter placements, these are variants of this. We also discussed that interaction is also essential for scatterplot-based variants, in particular for the advanced variants try to overcome the overplotting problem. Yeah, that's my summary. And at the end, let's briefly have a look at the references. I try to always make clear which information I use and cite everything, but I want to emphasize a few papers that I would recommend to you for reading. And I want to start with a paper from Cleveland and McGill, The Many Faces of a Scatterplot. That is from 1984. Yeah, the images don't look very modern, but the discussions still are up to date. That is a lot of in-depth knowledge of how to use scatterplots, enhance it with local regression lines, for example, in order to convey the information of pairwise data that is shown in scatterplots. I also want to recommend to you one link that you see here from Stephen Few, Solutions to the Problem of Overplotting in Graphs. Stephen Few is a person who designed and developed visualizations for commercial use, so he has a lot of experience from actual customers. So not only in this example, it's quite useful to read about his experiences. As an advanced strategy, I explained bint scatter plots and in particular variable bint scatter plots. I am aware that my description and explanation is probably not sufficient to fully understand this. If you are interested in this, please have a look in the paper from Hao, Dayal, Sharma, Keim and Janetsko, Variable Bint Scatterplots. I also presented another advanced variance in considerable detail, that was the Splatterplots paper from Mayorga and Gleicher from 2013 that appeared in IEEE TVCG. And finally, we discussed many details of a paper from Michael Sedelbayer, Tamara Manzner and Melanie Tori, Empirical Guidance on Scatterplot and Dimension Reduction Technique Choices, that also appeared in our premium journal in IEEE TVCG. Yeah, with this, I want you to thank you for your attention.